Indeed, I want to say a huge, huge welcome to those of you that are joining us for the very first time today. My name is Jeff. I have the privilege of pastoring here at Lifepoint Church. And so whether this is your first time or first time in a long time, we're glad to have you. I also want to say a big welcome to our Leland family. So Pine Valley, we make some noise for our Leland family. We love you guys. Leland, holler back at us. Love it. It's good having you guys with us. And super excited about this series. It's been fun. Good old-fashioned family reunion. And next week, if it's not on your calendar, it needs to be. All right? So get your phones out. Put down for next Sunday. We have a family fun day we're calling Pack the Point. Pack the Point. It's going to be the closest thing to an old-school homecoming Sunday that we do. And so we're asking everybody that has ever been through the doors of LifePoint to come back through the doors this coming Sunday, June the 9th. And so we would love to see you here. We want to make sure you grab some friends, bring them with you. This is at both campuses next weekend. So if you live in the Leland area, pack the point over there in Leland. Here in Pine Valley, we'll pack the point here. If you're watching online and you're within driving distance, how about coming on campus next weekend? There's a whole bunch of folks that would love to have you. And so next weekend, we want to make sure that you guys are here. It's going to be a good time. We're going to have a lot of fun for the family before and after services. So make sure you don't miss out on any of that. Well, as we go into part three of family reunion, I want to invite you to join me in a moment of prayer. Let's ask God to speak to us through this time together. Heavenly Father, thank you that we can gather and we can worship and we can celebrate. God, we don't take that freedom and that privilege lightly. We ask that today that as we get into your word, that you would speak to us. You tell us that your word is alive. It is active. It's sharper than a double-edged sword. And I believe that your word is going to bring a challenge to some today. I believe that your word is going to bring an encouragement to some today. But we ask that you would have your way in this time. We're grateful for you. We love you. We ask that today that you would open our hearts and our minds. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. So you're not going to get a family together without a bunch of food. Am I right? Am I right? What kind of a family gathering do you have if you don't have a bunch of food? So it just seems right to have a good old-fashioned family potluck, right? A potluck. I don't know if you've been to a potluck lately. I think it's been a long time since I've been to a potluck, and then in the past week, I've had two of them. What are the odds? Two potlucks. And so if you've been to a potluck in a while, you know that you got this smorgasbord of options. And it's always interesting when you get to the potluck because they're all the same, right? Table slam full of food, little kids that had nothing to do with contributing to the potluck, hovering at the front of the lines, about ready to take all the good stuff. When you finally get there, you grab your plate, and you gotta do what when you get to the potluck, right? You've got to scan the horizon. You got to weigh your options, because if you load up too soon on the wrong things, when you get to what you really want, there's no room, or you just keep stacking things and people start judging you. Which, who are we kidding? It's a family reunion. Why else would we get together but to judge our family members? And so when you get together at the potluck, I mean, there's all of these options. I love this. At every potluck, you've got two different types of foods. You have homemade and you have store-bought. Now, can we agree? It's not always that one is better than the other. Depends on the food, right? So I've never been mad when I saw the Bojangles box at a potluck. Never got mad. I was never like, shame on them. They didn't fix that at home. I mean, unless your grandmother has some killer fried chicken recipe, just stick with the box. Go with Bojangles. Nobody's gonna be mad. And do us all a favor and just get legs and thighs, okay? All dark meat. Can I get an amen from my dark meat folks? People want that dried out white meat. No. Dark meat. But then you've got, you know, the pasta salads that are usually better homemade. And then you've got, you know, the cookies. And there's, can we agree that there's two types of cookies. There are homemade chocolate chip cookies. Can I get an amen? Amen. And then there are the, we stopped at Food Lion on the way and bought the plastic. We appreciate the effort. But which of these trays is going to run out first? As the homemade, all day, every day. And then there is the fruit. We're grateful for fruit. We love watermelon and strawberries. And then there's the veggie tray. And low-carb life, not a lot happening for us here, except for maybe this broccoli. Then you've got the, you know, you got the crock pot with the beanie weenies. And then, I don't know who brings a pizza to a potluck, but again, I'm not mad. I imagine whoever brought the pizza, they smuggled in so nobody would know that they're the one that brought the pizza to the potluck. And then there's the box of tacos, which again, I'm not mad. Thank you. So I want to preach a message today that I titled Potluck Picnic. Potluck Picnic. I want you to take a note card out. You'll find these in the seat back in front of you. And if you're a digital note taker, you can go ahead and grab your phone and open the app. I don't care if you go digital, if you go old school, but I do think that there's something for everybody today. And I want you to write down a few key ideas through our message today. And I think that there's going to be some things God might kind of go, that's for you. And it might not even show up on the screen. And if you write it down, you'll remember it. So I want to encourage you to do that. But here's the thing. As a family and at a family potluck, everyone brings something to the table. Everyone brings something to the table when it comes to a potluck. And so I believe that when we gather as a church, it should feel like one big family reunion, potluck style, all of us bringing something to the table. We might have like a table full of desserts, table full of crock pots, table full of chips and dips. You know, it reminds me, the very first church I worked at had an actual building designated strictly for meals, for church meals. It was called the Fellowship Hall. And we don't have one of those, but we had this Fellowship Hall, and you knew that it was going to be a good day at church. You also knew it was going to be a high attendance day at church when a potluck followed Sunday morning. And so that was a good thing. Now, the church I grew up in, we didn't have a fellowship hall. We did something called Donut Sunday, and that was my favorite Sunday of the entire month. One weekend of the month, we all brought in donuts, and that was a great thing. Now, a lot of you did not grow up in a church. Many of you didn't grow up in church, period. Many of you didn't grow up in a church that did potlucks. And so I thought it would only make sense to share with you some principles of the potluck. So if you're taking notes, let me give you four principles of the potluck, all right? So if you've never been a part of a potluck or a church potluck, here's just a few tips to make the potluck successful. Number one is this. Everybody brings something. Write this down in your notes. Scribble down. Principle number one, everybody brings something. Everybody brings something. The only way a potluck works is if everybody chips in. Every family bringing something. Now, it's okay if you're like a guest and somebody invited you last minute. You know, you don't have to run out, although you could run out and get you the cookies or buy you a bag of chips. But the only way the potluck works is if everybody were to chip in. If only like 20% of those in attendance contribute to the potluck, what's going to happen? You're going to get to your turn in the line, and all you're going to have is some potato salad left. I have never gotten excited about potato salad. I heard that amen. Yes. And so principle number one is everybody brings something. Principle number two, second principle of the potluck is everybody brings something different. Everybody brings something different. Variety is the what? Spice of life, right? We need different. I mean, the first few moments as you grab your plate, you are scanning the table to size up what's there to figure out what it is that you want. Could you imagine what a bummer if you showed up and everybody brought the same thing to the potluck? Like, man, everybody brought a veggie tray. Worst potluck ever. It requires variety. Now, what's interesting is some of you don't have options in what you bring. Some of you are so good at a signature dish that should you show up to a potluck with anything else, people are going to get mad at you. You know it's true. So for Memorial Day, our staff had a Memorial Day / Pastor Jeff birthday get together. And man, it was great. It was so Pastor Daryl, our executive, he provided barbecue, killed it. It was amazing. And then everybody brought sides and dishes and all that. And by the time I finished with the barbecue, guys, I was stuffed to the rafters. I mean, I'm like sitting in the corner, misery setting in, like I think I overdid it. And I don't know why that is. There's more than enough food, but you know how when you go through the line, you're like, I better get enough just in case. Well, I got enough just in case, and I ate all of it. And then somebody said, Hannah brought her banana pudding. Now, for those of you who don't know, Pastor Daniel's wife, Hannah, has a signature dish. It's banana pudding. And when she brings banana pudding, you guys understand, I didn't grow up on banana pudding. That's kind of a Southern thing. And although I was born in Maryland, which is technically below the Mason-Dixon line, nobody considers us Southerners. We just didn't have that. We didn't grow up with banana puddings. Well, her banana pudding is incredible. And so when I heard Hannah brought banana pudding, I instantly got up from the corner. I was like, you know, third trimester pregnant woman, no offense, getting up out of my seat. That's what I looked like. Made my way over to the banana pudding. Went hard into the banana pudding. Why? Because that was her signature dish. Like she's, you know, you don't get that all the time. We need variety. We need difference. Some folks are dessert people. We love you. We appreciate you. Some folks are veggie tray people. Some folks are casserole people. Some folks are fruit salads. We won't point out who the fruit salads are. Some are award-winning chicken wing people. Some are deviled egg people. You know who you are. Listen, here's what I found is interesting. When you get to a potluck and you're standing in line, it is not uncommon and it is perfectly acceptable to turn to somebody and say, what'd you bring? What'd you bring? Everybody ever ask you, what'd you bring? Now, if you're the guy that brought the bag of chips, you're like, ah. You see, what happened was, like, we had it on the calendar, but we forgot about, you know. And so it's perfectly normal because we're family. And at a potluck, everybody brings something. Everybody brings something different. Principle number three is everybody shares with everybody. At the potluck, you bring something, you put it on the table, and it is fair game. Could you imagine if you showed up to the potluck and I'm over in the corner with my Bojangles box? Be like, bro, what'd you bring? I brought Bojangles. Could I get something? No. I brought this for me. Be like, bro, you don't understand how the potluck works. You put it on the table and it is open for anybody. This is where the beauty of the potluck comes in. I brought my best, my favorite. You bring yours. We put it out there. And instead of eating a bunch of what you brought, you get a little bit of what everybody has. So instead of one meal that is just chicken, you get a little chicken, a little bit of fruit, a little bit of veggies, a little bit of cookies, a little bit of pasta salad, a little bit of chips and dip. It's everything coming together, sharing with everybody. Principle number four, everybody eats. Everybody eats. Regardless of what you brought, you might have just brought like a bag of chips, you get the chicken. You might have brought the pizza, but you can also have the tacos. It's a beautiful thing. And at a potluck, everybody eats, regardless of what you're... Even if you didn't bring anything, you may be the mooch at the potluck. There's always one, right? There's always a mooch. Bring nothing, eat everything. And they'll have the audacity to get towards the front of the line. You're like, bro, we saw you walk in empty-handed. Back of the line, pal. We would never say that out loud. We would just think that. But everybody eats. Everybody eats. At a potluck, what's great is that there's power in the potluck. Is everything coming together? Everybody contributing. Everybody sharing. Everybody in this power in the potluck. At a potluck, you don't have a dinner without the dish. But conversely, the dish is not the same as the dinner. The dish makes the dinner. The dish makes the dinner, no dish, no dinner. All the same dish, boring dinner. A diversity of dishes equals a delicious dinner. You could say the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. And the Bible presents a very similar idea. If you got your Bibles, go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Let me show you this principle in Scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the Bible says this. Just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. Now you're like, Pastor, that has nothing to do with the potluck. What do you mean? Well, let me read it to you in potluck terms. Just as a potluck has many dishes, its many dishes form one potluck. So it is with the family of Christ. See, the church should look a lot like a potluck. It should look a lot like different people all coming together, all contributing to the greater good. And when the church does that, man, everybody eats and we get a diversity of goodness. Let's continue on in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 15. This idea of the church having many parts but still being one body gets drawn out. Let me show you this. Verse 15 says, now, if the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. That would be silly, right? That would be silly. The hand's like, well, I'm not the same as everything else. I'm not the same as the foot, therefore I don't belong. That's crazy, right? We're different. We're different. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're different. You're different. Some of you have been wanting to tell your neighbor they're different for a while now. You're different, not in a weird way, just in a different way. We're different, and that's a good thing. Variety, again, is the spice of life. We're different. We're different. So just because the ear says I'm not an eye doesn't mean it wouldn't belong. Verse 17, if the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of smell be? Right, if the whole potluck was a serving of watermelon, where would the chicken legs be? So we need different. We need different. If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? Verse 18, but in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, where? Say it with me. Just as he wanted them to be. So think about this. God made you the way that you are. God made you who you are. He gifted you with the talents and abilities that you possess, and he put you in a body, or you could say a family, to be a part of something bigger than yourself. He put you just where he wanted you to be. Then verse 19 says, if they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The point is this. Everyone is different. Everyone's different. Everyone is a part. There are many parts, one body. Many dishes, one dinner. And everyone belongs. Everyone's different. Everyone is a part. And everyone belongs. You have a place. You have a place in the family. I love this idea. The Bible gives us this picture of unity. We are one, but diversity, we are different. The church should have unity. We should stand together. We should belong together. We should be a part of a family. But we should be diverse. We should not all look the same, act the same, possess the same skills and abilities. There's something different about it. We are one family with many different family members. We are one, but we are different. We're better because we're different. Everybody has something to bring to the table. In this family, everybody can bring something to the table. And the power of the potluck is in the diversity of the dishes. What makes a great potluck is when you start seeing all the different dishes laid out on the table. And just like a potluck requires everyone to participate, so does the church. God has given power to the people. You possess gifts, skills, ability that I don't have. And I possess gifts and skills and abilities that you don't have. And when we come together, we're better and we're stronger. We're able to accomplish more. You are uniquely wired to be part of a family where your skills complement the rest. And as a family, everyone has roles and responsibilities. I don't know if there's any roles or responsibilities in your home. I know there's things we try to get our kids to do. You know, remember when your kids were little and they had a chore chart? You get a star on the chore chart if you accomplished your chores for the day. And when you did, maybe you got to go out for some froyo or donuts or there was something, but you had a role to play. You had a part. I want you to know that in the family of God, there are chores and responsibilities that go along with being part of the family, contributing to the family. If you were part of the family, there is a part for you to play. But what I want you to know is that most folks never discover their role or their part in the family. A lot of us are new to church, new to being around fellow believers and Christians. And it's easy to think that church is something we show up to. It's something we attend. It's something that's put on for us. We hope they play our favorite songs. We hope the message is good. We hope the coffee is fresh. What we don't realize is church is not something we attend. It's something we belong to. And that if we know Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we're part of the family and we are the church. You are the church. And the church exists to reach those who are not yet here. When Jesus said, I'll build my church and the gates of hell won't prevail against it, he was empowering people to be the church and then to go and be Jesus to the community. So if you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the church does not exist for you. You are the church and you exist to serve and love and reach the world. I want you to know the church, this church, will only be as effective as its people are active. That the more people that discover their role here at the church, the more we're able to serve our community. So let me ask you a question. What is your role? When we look at the potluck, what is your contribution? What is it that you would say, Pastor, here's what I think I bring to the table. Here's the skills. Here's what I'm willing to contribute. This is how God has wired me. Because I want you to know that just like this potluck would be nothing without the diversity of dishes, this church will not be as effective in our communities without you and your gifts and your skills and your ability. And so what's your dish in potluck speak? What is it that you would say, I bring to the table? Everybody has something to bring to the table. Now you may say, Pastor, you don't know me. I'm new to church. I don't know my Bible very well. I don't know how to, you know, do a lot of the different things. Nobody's ever asked me. I want you to know that all you gotta do to be a part of the family is show up. We talked about that part one. You just show up. If you will show up, this family will embrace you and teach you and show you how to be a part of the team. We'd love to have you a part of what we do here. But let me ask you this question, okay? Let me ask you this question. I'm having put up on the screen. I want you to think about this for a second. If everybody in this family, speaking of our church family, our Leland family, our Pine Valley family, if everybody in this family served to the degree that you do, and you can personalize it to the degree that I do, would LifePoint be more or less effective at reaching this community? So let's just be honest. Don't answer that out loud. But if everybody served to the level that I do, to the level that you do, would the church be more or less effective because of that? That's a great question to wrestle through because a lot of us love an active church, but the only way we have an active church is if we have active church family, if we all contribute. Again, we will only be as effective as we are active. I love it when Jesus looked out at the people, he said, man, the harvest is plentiful. There are so many folks that need hope and need healing. He said, the harvest is plentiful, the harvest is ripe, the harvest is ready. And then he said, but the workers are few. And there's not a lot of folks willing to roll up their sleeves and say, put me in, coach. I'm ready to play. Where do you need me? I could be a part of this. I want to make it happen. And the more people participating, the more harvest, the more people we get to be a part of impacting and touching their lives. I think that it, for every single person, every Christian, at some part in the maturing process, we go from what's in it for me. We go from being the kids at the front of the line, just ready to charge forward to the desserts, to being the adults that have prepped the food, that have put it on the table, that are letting other people get to the front of the line. We go from being served to being the servants, making it happen for other people. I think when it comes to church, you are only as mature as the level of service you're willing to provide for other people. And so as we grow, there is this maturing process. There's this giving back. It's no longer about what I can get. It's about what I can give. I'm part of the family. And here at LifePoint, we have an incredible team that serves every single week across both of our campuses. Now, some roles are visible. You see them. Some roles are invisible. They're behind the scenes. But all of them are important. I want you to think for just a minute about our guest services. The thing about our guest services is they touch literally every single person that comes through our doors over the course of a weekend. Our guest services team is incredible. On an average weekend, we'll have anywhere between 150 and 180 volunteers serving through guest services across both of our campuses. That's pretty awesome. That's pretty awesome. I mean, that's a whole bunch of folks that make Sunday happen. If you're not a part of one of those teams, I need you to know this church would be horrible if it wasn't for our volunteers and our dream team that make this place incredible. They are the secret sauce of LifePoint. There would be no special touches. There would be no fresh coffee. There would be none of that if it wasn't for the team that makes this place incredible. I think about it. We have parking lot. We have a parking team that sets the tone for the entire day. You know, when you come into the parking lot and you see these guys with foam fingers and they're helping you find a spot, and sometimes they got lightsabers out there, I mean, they have a good old time. And I know that you could find your own parking spot on your own. Nobody's out there at Harris Teeter helping us get, you know, a parking spot. Nobody's at Walmart or the mall directing, well, nobody's at the mall, period, but you know what I mean. Nobody's, we can find our own parking spot. Why in the world would we put people out there? Well, that's a great question. I'm glad you asked. Because we understand that for most people, showing up to a new church after having not been in church a while is a little bit of an anxiety attack. There's a lot of folks that they don't know what's going to happen. They don't know if they're going to come in, be handed a cup of Kool-Aid. You know, they don't really know what's going on when they get in. So let's just meet people where they are. Let's set up the sermon in the parking lot. Let's show people they're loved in the parking lot. That's what they're doing. They're not helping you find a parking spot. They're showing you that you're welcome and you're loved. A lot of you may not have said that when you showed up for your first time, but when you think back, you're like, oh yeah, that was pretty cool that somebody was out there to meet me and direct me and point me in the right direction. I think about our greeters. Our greeters are there holding the doors, telling you that they're glad to see you, saying hi to you when you make your way in. A lot of folks wonder, when I walk through the doors, is anybody even going to care that I'm there? So a lot of folks that can slip in and slip out, nobody ever says anything. Well, we don't want that to be the case because we're thrilled, we're honored that you're here. We're honored. If you're here at LifePoint for the first time, I hope you understand the reason we do this, because we've been praying that someday you would show up. We started LifePoint with like very few people, but this crazy dream of impacting an entire region. But we didn't know if anybody was going to show up. And we thought, you know what? If we truly believe that we walk by faith, then let's put people at the doors believing that guests are going to show up. And then they do. And we've got an incredible team that's greeting folks and talking to folks and facilitating conversations, and helping them get information, helping them get their kids checked in. It matters. It matters. And then you make your way in and then you grab yourself a cup of coffee, fresh, hot, locally roasted coffee. Man, there's something about a good cup of coffee. You could go buy yourself coffee at the gas station or McDonald's or Starbucks. On the way in, you could do that. We'd be like, you know what? If they want coffee, buy their own coffee. Coffee's expensive. I mean, we go through gallons and gallons and I think it's like, it's like 25, 50, it's crazy amounts of gallons. I mean, they are literally making coffee as I speak right now for upcoming services. Just coffee, coffee, coffee. We are so caffeinated. You're like, Pastor, you are so caffeinated. Trust me, I only run on caffeine on Sunday mornings. It is coursing through my veins. It's actually the secret sauce of LifePoint. We've been saying as the volunteers, it's really the coffee. No, but it's, why do we do that? Because we just, there's something about providing coffee for folks. I don't know, we love it. It's a way of saying, like, we're glad you're here. If you came over to my house, I'd say, would you like some coffee? So here, at our house, would you like some coffee? We care about you. And then I think about making your way into the auditorium and you're trying to find a seat. It's a little overwhelming when you've got hundreds of people coming into a room all looking for a seat, and everybody wants to sit on the aisle, and there's only so many aisles. And so we have a team of ushers. It's like, you ever been to the movies, and it was packed? Like, maybe you went to see Avengers Endgame, and you showed up early. I showed up almost an hour early to see that movie. The line was out the door, and so when you got in, it was a hot mess of people, and it was like, because nobody wants to sit next to stranger, right? Stranger danger and the whole seating thing. So what do? You take up your seats. Of course, if you're like several guys, you take up like the entire row because you don't want to sit next to each other because it's a guy man code. And so you leave empty seats. And then so now a family of four comes in, but you've got only, you know, one or two empty seats because you wouldn't scoot down. So now the theater's only half full, but it's packed out. So it was funny, when I was at Avengers Endgame, I saw some Lifepointers there. I won't shout out who you are, but it was like a team from our kids ministry, and they were like, you know, they sent the spies in early to scout out the seats. And so it was like, man, this is an awesome couple, the kindest people ever, and they're literally like, we've got like nine seats. So one's on one end, one's on the other, and there's like the international code of these are taken here in the middle. And the theater was filling up, and this guy and his family come rolling in, you know, tub of popcorn in hand. And he's trying, he's like, excuse me. And they're like, no, I'm sorry, sir, we're saving these seats. And as loud as he could, he goes, you can't save seats in a movie theater. And he just blows by him and sits right in the middle. Didn't even scoot out, just these are my seats. And I watched this couple, because they're so nice. I was like, oh man, I'm about to see them kind of get a little angry. And they didn't. They were just totally Jesus. It was like, well, I guess you can have these seats then. And kudos to those guys. And John and Alicia are amazing. I mean, those who shall go unnamed are amazing. But I was like, man, you need some ushers up in this movie theater. And I know sometimes, you know, we joke, man, I love ushers. They're like the unsung heroes. But they make the room make sense. And so don't ever get upset at them if they ask you to scoot down. They're just trying to maximize and get people in. But I want you to know that it matters. Behind the scenes, you know, we've got teams all over just making this place what it is. We got our tech teams, like stuff shows up on the screen and comes out of the speakers. And you don't ever see those guys. We keep them locked in a closet in the back, and they're pushing buttons and pulling levers. And they're just amazing. And I tell you all of that because I want you to know that it takes a diversity of people to make this place what it is. It's one big potluck. It's everybody bringing their best. Everybody serving one another. You know, there's a quote, I couldn't figure out who to attribute it to, so if you tweet this or post it, you can just give me credit. It says, people may forget what you said, but they will never forget how you made them feel. Now, that's not very encouraging if you're the guy that stands on stage for 35 minutes and runs his mouth. It means that when folks show up here, they'll forget what I said. Oh, Pastor, you had that message. It was powerful. You talked about something out of the Bible. It was so good. So good. People will forget what I said. But they're not going to forget that someone met him in the parking lot and someone met him at the door and someone helped him find a seat and someone cared for their kid. It matters. It matters. It's a big deal. And I know it's really easy to come in and see that it looks like all the roles are covered. They don't need anybody else, man. They got volunteers everywhere. Well, I want you to know it's not necessarily that we need more people. It's that I think you need to find your place in the family. You need to roll up your sleeves and you need to be a part. You need to be able to utilize the gifts and skills and abilities that God has given to you. Now, maybe you're thinking, you know, no one's ever asked me. I had a friend of mine just messaged me on Instagram just yesterday and said, hey, I want to start serving. I want to get connected at church. How do I do that? I said, well, just hang tight. I'm going to talk about that this Sunday. And I want you to know that we have opportunities. If you've never been asked, consider this your invitation. That this team will be better with you on it. And you will be better being a part of this team. So we're going to do something today that we don't typically do. Following the service in just a few minutes when I dismiss, we're gonna give those of you that have not taken a step to be a part of the team a chance to take that step. And so at both of our campuses, our host will come out at the end. They'll kind of tell you where to go. We you know, your kids are already checked in. And so it's gonna take about 10 minutes for you to hear some of the opportunities that we've got right now. We could utilize people literally this coming week and in the weeks to come. And we just need to know who they are. And so we'll give you details on exactly where to go. It'll take about 10 minutes and then you can be on with your day. But we'll share specific roles at each campus where we could best put you in play. And this is what I know about you. I know you love your church. It's obvious you wouldn't be here on a beautiful day. You could be at the beach. You could be out on the water. You're here because you love your church. You just have never been given the invitation to take a step and be a part of the team that makes it happen. Well, I want this to be your invitation, and we would love to help you take this step. And so when we dismiss our service host, to kind of tell you where you need to go. But before I do that, before I close, I just want to say this again. I want you to know that you belong. You're going to be bombarded with thoughts about why you can't serve and your schedule this and you're not talented and you don't know the Bible very well and this and that. And listen, God didn't mess up when he made you. He created you on purpose and he created you for a purpose. And I believe that you come alive when you find your purpose in the family of God. When you look around at our team of volunteers, I can tell you this much, most of those folks had never done that before. They'd never done it. We offer on-the-job training. And there's something about gathering together with that team, celebrating what God is doing, and knowing that you got to be a part of making the potluck happen. So I want to pray for you, and I want to encourage you to take that step, whatever it is that God is putting ahead of you in your journey with him. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for who you are. Thank you, God, for the invitation that you give us to be a part of what you're doing in your family. We're grateful for you. Lord, we love you. I'm thankful for the many, for the hundreds of volunteers every week that make this place what it is. It would not be without them. But God, I know there are hundreds more that have just been waiting for an invite, waiting for the opportunity. Lord, I pray that you would continue to grow our team so that we can continue to meet the needs all around this community. And at the end of the day, God, would you get the glory and would you get the honor? We love you, Lord. We're thankful that we get to be a part of what you're doing. We pray this in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Come on, church. Can we put our hands together for one big potluck family reunion?